Okay, thanks. Looks like our participant numbers have settled in, so we'll get started. Thank you very much for taking the time to join us today. My name is Max Brunette, and I'm with my colleague, Amy-Lynn Kosick. We're both members of Gowling WLG's Employment and Labor group in Western Canada. We both are called and split our time between Vancouver and Calgary. So we appreciate you joining us today. Just a brief bit of background on us. Amy's been practicing for about 10 years. I've been practicing for about 20. We are, as was probably assumed, management side employment and labor lawyers. We've been act on behalf of a number of national or multinational or international corporations, as well as small and medium businesses, different sizes. What we were hoping to chat to you about today is largely it's been a very busy year in the employment law space with the pandemic, and we've seen some trends over the course of the year and some issues that are commonly coming up in the context of the pandemic. So why we thought this might be topical now is in the early days of the COVID-19 pandemic, and I would describe that as March, April, and May, we saw for our practice group just a huge influx of employers forced into situations where they either had to let employees go, they had to consider temporary layoff measures that were available to them, or they had to look at other cost-cutting measures such as salary reductions or compensation reductions to survive through that pandemic time. So that was really quite hit a crest, I'd say, in about April or May. And then through the course of the summer, obviously that it was good news, more of a good news story. There was more hiring going on as far as we could tell, and less layoff, reduction, termination type activity. But what we're seeing now is with, the apparent second wave upon us and what looks to be more potential restrictions on employers' ability to operate or the just public's ability to move about, perhaps coming down the pipe in different jurisdictions, we're starting to get more of those calls in terms of, okay, how do we manage through this if it's another a few months of restricted activity? So we're going to cover a few topics, and if I could maybe jump over to slide two there. Some of the issues and challenges we've seen with respect to workplace reorganizations. We'll talk about a topic that's come up quite a bit, and that is employee considerations. So, what do you do, for example, with employees who have childcare responsibility foisted upon them or simply refuse to return to work because they have a perception of safety in the workplace? And then we'll talk a little bit about some of, and this could really be a topic altogether, number three, but some of your safety and privacy considerations. What's WorkSafe BC saying with respect to your COVID-19 safety plans that you need to have in place, and whether or not we're seeing an increased trend in inspections and that sort of thing. So we hope this has got some useful tidbits throughout the course of our chat today. Amy and I will probably talk for approximately 30 to 40 minutes, and we'll leave some time on the back end for questions. We've got a Q&A that you can enter your questions in at the bottom of the screen, and we'll do our best. Despite both being technological Luddites, we will do our best to field those questions and get you some answers. But if we don't, certainly do not hesitate to follow up with us. So if I could jump over to slide three. So what are the primary things we've seen this year across all of our clients? So, I mean, I would say this, it's not been industry specific. I've seen it across retail, agriculture, energy, industrial services, supply services. I haven't seen one sector of our clientele that hasn't had some COVID impact or been forced to make some level of restructuring changes. So it's been quite widespread and pervasive in terms of its impact, at least anecdotally from our perspective. If we could jump over to slide four, and through to slide five, please. Next one. Thank you. So now I don't purport to really go through the termination basics in much detail here. I think many people who are joining us, say, for the webinar will be aware that if you're forced into a situation where layoffs and permanent terminations become a reality for you, I think most people know you've got an obligation to pay out under the statute, and in addition, pay some amount of common law notice. Of course, if you have a contract or an employment contract in place that has a severance clause, you'll want to rely upon that. So good news if you have that. I would say as an aside, when there's tough times like this and a greater number of reductions, plaintiff counsel get more creative in terms of how they look to attack severance offers that have been put out, whether that's attacking the value of the offer that you've provided. We see that a lot. I don't think I've seen a demand letter in the last 6 months that hasn't suggested that the COVID-19 pandemic creates a mitigation issue, in the sense that it is more difficult for employees to find work during a downturn like this. So each and every plaintiff counsel is putting that into a demand letter these days, seeking an extension of the notice period. So to the extent you do not have an employment contract in place and you've gone through the process of making an offer to somebody that incorporates the statute and sets some common law amount of notice, be prepared for that ask on the extended notice period due to COVID-19. We can say, generally speaking, that courts will sometimes consider the current economic climate and the job opportunities available as a factor that may extend the notice period. But the case is on point. I would describe it not to be necessarily material extensions of that notice period. I mean, we're talking about, I find most of the time the cases I've looked at, 1 to 3 months. We're not looking at a doubling of notice periods. We've been keeping an eye out to see if there's any judgments that have come down the pipe that where a judge has specifically incorporated the pandemic into an extension of the notice period. Haven't seen anything yet in BC, knock on wood on that point. But that's not to say it's coming. You know, the decisions and their release are always a little bit delayed, and this sort of stuff is probably working its way through the system right now. So I wouldn't be surprised to see some more noteworthy decisions on that point coming out in the fall. So stay tuned on that piece. The other, and maybe we'll jump over to the next slide. The other aspect we're seeing is, and this I don't think is COVID-19 driven, but to the extent you have to get into terminations and you're seeking to rely upon a contractual severance clause, we see all sorts of different lines of attacks on the clauses these days. So it's often a two-pronged attack, which is your clause has some level of ambiguity in it. I think many people who are joining us today will be familiar with some of these. The idea is if you're seeking to rely on a clause that prescribes a rate of severance, your wording has to be absolutely clear and you have to ensure that you are complying with the statute. And so plaintiff employee counsel have been very creative about different ways to attack it. And I feel like Ontario is putting out a decision pretty much every other month where some ambiguity has been found in a clause and the clause has been held void. And the corresponding reality is plaintiff counsel jump all over that. So we see lots of different attacks right now on employment clauses. That's not to say you have to fold the tent. Your clause, you know, may be better than some of the more dated ones. You can always take the position that it's binding and force that employee into a position of litigating over the validity of the clause, which is not necessarily an easy thing to do. But I would say as a general rule, if you are using these clauses, take a peek at them, see what they look like, see what the language looks like, because frankly, we're updating ours every 6 months based on the latest case law. So if you are finding yourself where the second wave of the pandemic is going to put you into termination scenarios this fall, think about the validity of your contracts and whether or not they're going to stand up to challenge. If things are more dire and you're looking at a situation where you may be dealing with group terminations, BC has some very specific rules with respect to the amount of notice that needs to be provided. And you want to make sure that you're paying attention to this, because if we could jump over to slide 8, they are, I would say, somewhat onerous notice requirements. So if you find yourself having to go through a major layoff, the numbers are there in front of you. It's 8 weeks for termination of 50 to 100 employees, 12 for 101 to 300, and 16 weeks before that. The real kicker here is the way these provisions used to work across most of the country was, in reality, the group termination notices was to give the ministers to give the government a heads up that they may be dealing with noteworthy terminations, potential, you know, increased uptick on people claiming EI, and really just more of an administrative thing. But over time, they've been given more teeth. And so if you miss these notice requirements, you can find yourself having to add that on to whatever else you're going to owe. So if you miss the 16 weeks, you're going to have to cut a check for 16 weeks of termination pay, plus the individual notice required under the code, plus whatever your common law notice is. So in BC, this has got some teeth. So if you're in the unfortunate situation of having to deal with this, you know, please do think about it, because it can become quite costly if you miss it. Could we jump over to the next slide? Now, an interesting two things to note, both with respect to group terminations and individual terminations, is that the BC government, actually, let me step back. One issue on the group terminations to think about is the concept of single location. And this is an issue that we've looked at some level of detail. So it may be the case. So if you think about a situation where you've got, let's say a retail, you're in retail and you've got 12 locations across Metro Vancouver. It is arguable that each, and let's say it's a store closure right across the board. Okay, you've got to close all 12. We think you can reasonably take the position, assuming that each location has some standalone characteristics to it, its own supervisors, its own managers, that all of them should not be aggregated, and that each location could be considered in its own. So while all 12 closed across Metro Van might trip you over 50, if there's some level of independence amongst those stores, we think you had a decent argument to say that the group termination provisions don't apply. We had to look at that in the context, in that very context. And the conclusion we came to, there's not a lot of great case law out there on that point, but it's really going to come down to a matter of each store's standalone independence. So think about that if that becomes an issue. And another interesting feature to the ESA with respect to some publications put out by the BC government earlier this year is the thought or the concept of, if you do find yourself again in a termination scenario, whether or not you can rely on what are essentially the frustration provisions of the Act. And you can see it highlighted there at 60, at D. Okay, and it says, you know, employed under an employment contract that's impossible to perform due to unforeseeable events or circumstance. So really what the government is saying, what employment standards is saying there is, if you've been shuttered by virtue of the pandemic and public health orders, certain tourism businesses might come to mind, gyms, for example, something like that, you might have an option here where you don't have to provide the statutory termination notice or the group termination notice. And then I would argue the adjunct to that, or the build on to that, is that you'd be seeking to make that same argument with respect to any common law notice that you might owe the employees if you're in a termination scenario, or perhaps even the contractual notice that's owed. Of course, that will be somewhat dependent on the language of your contract. If we could jump over to the next slide. But be careful here. Anytime a client calls me and wants to talk about frustration as a potential out to whether or not it owes severance, it's always a cautionary tale. And I always say, look, you got to tread lightly in this area. And we think the same is still going to apply with respect to this statutory exception if you seek to rely on it. And if we could jump over to the next slide. The government of BC really has actually put out some guidelines. I was looking for cases last night and this morning to see if anything's come out that really tests this yet, and I couldn't find anything on my last run through, but we did find some guidelines here. And so you can see them set out, and it's, you know, an establishment that you're unable to open as a result of a public health order is one. You're unable to adapt public health guidelines. That would be a trickier one, a trickier fight to get into, I think, depending on the nature of your business. And the third is that you've had permanent closure. So permanent closure is, you know, if you're in that unfortunate situation, you've probably got a better argument there. But, you know, as an example, if you were teetering on the edge of bankruptcy or significant financial trouble pre-COVID, and COVID was sort of what pushed you over the edge, that may not be something that was unforeseeable. So you may find yourself in a more difficult situation there. Or if you're a multinational or national organization and the decision is, you know, the vast majority of your operations are continuing in different locations, but there's some geographical component as to why you're getting out in Vancouver or the interior of BC, be prepared to be challenged on that front. You know, so these, we don't think these are necessarily going to be easy cases to win, except in, I would say, the more obvious or more dire circumstances. Certainly if you're a smaller business or a medium-sized business, and the impact of the pandemic is obvious, we think you're going to get a better shake from an adjudicator here. If you're a multinational, national, that might be a tougher putt based on your overall financial health, and you're going to have to split out the objective financial data for the region to really demonstrate and show trouble on that front. So that's our expectation there. If we could jump over to the next slide. So the you know, I've talked a little bit about terminations. If you're in that unfortunate reality of having to cut back on some of your workforce, those are some key issues to think about that we've seen pop up over the pandemic. One tool that a lot of our clients utilize through the pandemic and maybe looking at again as the second wave gathers steam is temporary layoffs. I'm going to turn this over to Amy, who's going to walk you through how you can utilize these provisions potentially to your advantage to stave off terminations if possible.
Thanks, Max. So the temporary layoffs were a pretty popular topic when we first saw the pandemic coming out. And, you know, we've seen that peter off a little bit, and I'll kind of talk about why. But as Max mentioned, this may be something we see a resurgence of depending on how the pandemic turns. But basically, for our purposes, under the ESA, the main concern is a temporary layoff, any layoff, you're permitted to do it for up to 13 weeks in a 20-week period. So that's the general rule. And we'll talk about how that was modified in a second. But you should also be aware that aside from unilaterally or by agreement putting someone on temporary layoff, if you end up providing the employee with less work such that their earnings decrease by 50%, that could also constitute a layoff. So we've seen that happen as a result of some of the other changes employers have implemented or tried to implement, including salary reductions. And we're going to talk about salary reductions as well, but just be aware that you may accidentally or inadvertently trigger a layoff provision if you're going down that road. In BC, there's not a statutory notice requirement for temporary layoffs. And I just wanted to point that out because in some of the other provinces, you do have to provide, you know, 1 to 2 weeks notice in most circumstances for a layoff, for example, in Alberta. But in BC, you could make it effective immediately. Also, you can apply to variances to vary the time period that you can lay off employees. And I'll talk about that more in a minute, but that's a pretty specific procedure that you have to contact the Director of Employment Standards to do. So if we can go to the next slide, one of the things I just wanted to highlight, and again, we'll talk about this a little more, is something called constructive dismissal. Essentially, if you don't have a right to layoff in your agreement, which many employers do not, then it can bring about a risk of constructive dismissal. And obviously, prior to the pandemic, most employers who had cyclical employees had these layoff provisions, but many employers didn't because their reductions in workforce were permanent as opposed to temporary. And we're seeing a lot more employers having to rely on layoffs as a result of the pandemic, but unfortunately they're not in their employment agreements. And that does trigger a risk of constructive dismissal. We can just go to the next slide. I just wanted to talk about some of the variances that were put into place to address the pandemic, including increases to the temporary layoff period. So the first one that kicked in May, it extended the layoff period to 16 weeks in a 20-week period. We then saw in June an additional extension to 24 weeks in a 28-week period. However, all of these extensions ended August 30th. There was a limited time where you could apply to the director to vary the end date of August 30th, but that was a hard deadline that you had to apply for that variance by August 30th. So now we're back to business as usual, which is 13 weeks in a 20-week period. And if you need more than that, you're going to have to apply specifically for a variance. We can just go to the next slide. So this is basically what I was touching on, just that if it's not in your contract, there's a risk of constructive dismissal. Again, in order to claim constructive dismissal, you have to have an employee effectively quit and allege termination. And what we saw through the pandemic was sort of what I would term a bit of a unique situation. Many employees did not want to quit and allege constructive dismissal, notwithstanding that they didn't have a contractual right or that they hadn't subsequently agreed to the layoff. And that was, that's just, I think, simply because there's not a lot of other job opportunities for them around, and most employees are banking on being recalled. So I would say that there was a fair amount of employers that got away with layoffs, notwithstanding they're not in their contracts. That being said, I do currently have on my desk a number of claims from employee and plaintiff side counsel, relating to the layoffs and claiming that there was breaches of contract as a result of that. And in fact, some of these claims have resulted where employees haven't been recalled after the layoff. That's primarily where I'm seeing them. And they're trying to seek to invalidate termination provisions on that basis. And, you know, whether or not that would be successful is another story. But needless to say, as Max said, we're seeing plaintiff and employee counsel take harder runs at these things. So just be aware, if it's not in your agreements or the employee hasn't consented to it, there is definitely a legitimate risk of constructive dismissal there. And just to, if we can go to the next slide, just to give you a broader idea of what constructive dismissal is, because it's going to touch on my next topic as well. It's a unilateral change to a fundamental term of employment that the employee doesn't agree to. And so that can vary from many things, but it does encompass layoffs, and it will also encompass salary reductions. Which brings us to the next topic. So if we can go to slide 20. So many employers, as we've talked about, have turned to reductions in salaries, freezing of bonuses, alterations to calculations of benefits. We've seen a wide variety of sort of modifications to salaries being proposed. Some of them have been done with consent of employees, which is fine, and some of them have not. Where it has not, employers should be aware that in general, compensation is viewed as one of the most fundamental terms of an employment relationship. And so there may be a risk of constructive dismissal. And I say maybe because it really depends on the total overall reduction in compensation you're seeing. So we're not just looking at base salary or benefits, we're looking at the whole package and how much are you decreasing. And we generally like to look at it as on a percentage basis. And, you know, it's not, there isn't a bright line, so to speak, of exactly what salary reduction will trigger you into a constructive layoff or a constructive dismissal. And if you turn to the next slide, you can see here, we've kind of outlined some of the basics of it and some case law where they've said 25% is and 9-4 is not. The case law is not completely consistent. We do find that salary reductions exceeding 10% in general carry with them a high risk of constructive dismissal, but it is a gray area. So anything below 10% we view as a lower risk, and it's kind of viewed as a minor loss of income. And so it's important to look at that and also the type of compensation you're impacting. So base salaries viewed more critically. And you also want to look at whether there were discretionary or past practices with respect to changes in the compensation. So there's some pretty strong case law indicating, for example, if you had a history of modifying your RSP contributions or something like, or not awarding bonuses during times when the companies were not performing well, that's not going to trip you into the constructive dismissal area.
I might just add one quick point to that. Amy, and that is, you know, anecdotally, I've seen unilaterally imposed reductions of pushing up to 20% in different sectors over the past year. And so, you know, ordinarily, we'd tell you right off the hop, you're in pretty fertile ground for a constructive dismissal complaint. But in, you know, what we're finding, frankly, I think I've seen two claims out of a huge number of employees who've been impacted by reductions of that nature. And really a lot of it just comes down strategically, how do you implement it? And, you know, a lot comes down to the messaging that's used, right? So what I've seen done effectively is employers will announce to their workforce, look, we need you to partner with us through this difficult period. This is intended to be temporary. So for the 2020 fiscal year, for the next 6 months, we're implementing this reduction. But, you know, the minute we think we've got stability or things are back on track, we'll be, you know, pulling that back. So you get a lot of partnership on that. I guess what I would say is where you've got to watch it a little bit is if you initially position it as temporary and then it becomes permanent, obviously you're back into fertile ground for a constructive dismissal complaint. But that ordinarily, you know, another thing to think about in the constructive dismissal space is condemnation. So if you make a change, and let's say you don't message it as temporary, if an employee works under the revised terms for, and again, there's no bright line here that you can point to, but for a period of months, you as an employer at some point have a pretty decent condemnation argument, which is to say you accepted the change to your employment and therefore it's now binding. So strategy and messaging and the rhetoric that's used, I think, is everything in terms of trying to get buy-in here. And that's what I've seen done successfully over the last little while.
Yeah, I would agree. And I'd also add that if you're communicating it as temporary or you have a specific end date in it, the condemnation argument likely will not apply there because the employee will probably have been deemed to accept it as a temporary change. And then once you go beyond that, I think you'd get into more of the risk. And also you need to, one of the things that helps in terms of strategy, as Max was pointing out, is what are the other terms of employment? So are you, if you're not modifying anything else, so there's not a corresponding demotion or something else going along with the salary reduction, that's generally more acceptable. Whereas when you throw other things in there, like a change in title or demotion, you're really going to start tripping more into the constructive dismissal risk. And employees may or may not accept that. Like Max said, we've seen more employees be willing to accept these terms throughout the pandemic.
Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about some returning to work considerations. And I know we're sort of spanning a number of topics here, and some of these I suspect could be a half hour in and of themselves. So if we may not cover everything in exactly the level of detail you're looking for, but we're hoping to really flag sort of the main issues for you. So, one very common call we're getting is, you know, how to deal with people who are either not wanting to return in the context of the pandemic. And, you know, to be frank, a lot of it was, I got this call a lot. I think my employees are currently enjoying CERB or other government benefits. And we're getting back what we think are sort of overstated concerns about the safety of our workplace. So that was a fairly common concern. And the way we tended to address that was to, what you have to do is, if you go to WorkSafe BC, for example, they have return to work guidelines. And in fact, they're industry specific in terms of what they expect you to do for developing a COVID-19 safety plan and hazard assessments and those sorts of things. So where I figure you can't lose on this front is if you're matching up with what WorkSafe BC is recommending as the guidelines that you follow. And then conversely, you're dealing with an employee who's being difficult with respect to alleging safety concerns. At some point, you can say that that employee is no longer being reasonable and perhaps start to ratchet up the pressure for that employee to return. Ideally, you want to work that out between yourself and the employee. What you've got to be wary of in these circumstances are two things. And maybe if we could jump to the next slide, Jen. There's a couple of things to watch. One is that, and I've only seen this twice in the last 7 months, but the employee can go to WorkSafe BC, register a complaint with respect to their concerns, which puts you in a situation then dealing with an inspector to essentially adjudicate whether or not the employee has a reasonable basis for returning and whether or not the employer has done what they can to mitigate COVID risks in the workplace. In both instances, I found the inspector was quite reasonable and sided with the employer. So that was good news there, but you may not necessarily always get that. And of course, a lot's going to depend on the extent and effort you've put into matching up your COVID-19 safety plan with what is prescribed or recommended by WorkSafe. But so the takeaway there is, you know, do your best to work it out directly with the employee so you can avoid having to have WorkSafe BC involved in your business. But we've had a couple of good results, so maybe it's not the end of the world. So that's one issue we've seen. The other is what I've got on the screen. And Shannon, if you could jump to the next one. Of course, this is, I think, something that hits home for all of us. At some level, our schedules have been altered, and you've got to be live to people's family situations here. And of course, the Act now at 52.12 sub 2 has provided a form of job protected leave, not paid, of course, but job protected leave for people who are suddenly have difficult family care circumstances thrust upon them. And you've got to, in addition to that amendment to the code, you've always got to think about your human rights obligations as well. And that's where this expanded concept of family status kicks in. So, we've seen a few different things in this area. Okay. The simplest being an unpaid leave where the person is taking some time off and may return when things get back to normal. Easy enough, but not every scenario is that cut and dry. Where it gets a little more complicated is scenarios where employees will still want to work, but may not be able to work at the same level of productivity because of their childcare arrangements. Are you, in that circumstance, required to pay them their full salary for lesser work? Not necessarily. I would suggest that opens up a scenario where, they're keeping their job, but you're only paid for services you provide. And I think it's not unreasonable to get a situation where you might negotiate some reduced measure of compensation for the period of time that the alternative care arrangements are required by that employee. But that's been a very common complaint is, well, look, now my worker's only doing, 9 to 3, but I'm still paying salary at full rate. How long do we have to do that for? So I've yet to come across a case where an employee has refused that change in compensation for a temporary period and has sued. I think it's got to be coming down the pipe soon. I haven't seen a case like it yet, but that's something to keep in mind. But in that scenario, if you are under financial strain and you have found the productivity has changed, it's not a negotiation that you necessarily need to shy away from. If we could jump to the next slide, Sharon. Next one after that. So, thinking about this more broadly and what are some of the lessons here in terms of what you got to do, with respect to WorkSafe BC, their website's getting better. I found in the early days of the pandemic, they were behind in things, understandably so. But the guidelines are now quite specific and industry specific. And of course, there is a mandate to have a COVID-19 safety plan in place. And they put the ominous sort of marker in there that says, look, WorkSafe BC will be reviewing plans of individual employers to ensure they're compliant. I've had that come up twice in the last 6 months where there's been a surprise inspection. Okay. And unfortunately, in both cases, the employer had pretty decent COVID protocols in place. But I've not heard of it beyond that. That's not to say it's happening, but to the extent that our client base is representative of the BC economy, it doesn't look like it's happening too much. In the same publication, they say, look, if you're not up to speed on the COVID-19 protocols and planning, you may be subject to fines. I've looked over the last couple of days. This morning, I went back as far as February of this year to see if I could find any penalties issued by WorkSafe BC with respect to a failure to implement an appropriate COVID plan. I could not find one. I looked through about 200 decisions. It's not to say that they're not out there somewhere, but if you trust the comprehensiveness of the list, I wasn't seeing much there. So some good news there. And that suggests to me that even if you do get an inspection, or even if this does become a point of discussion between you and WorkSafe, that they're being reasonable in terms of probably allowing the lawyers to get, employers to get up to speed on that front. So a bit of good news there. And then we've got here, so again, and this is connected to the point about employees who may or may not want to come back to work. I mean, your best point of reference again are these WorkSafe BC guidelines in terms of showing your compliance, trying to stay in lockstep with what they're recommending and what the provincial health officers are recommending. I mean, the best you can there, I mean, that's got to be your guidelines. You know, where you get into trouble in these spaces is if you adopt policies that are more aggressive than what the current, you know, WorkSafe BC guidelines are proposing. And that's where you get variances. But again, we're not seeing penalties yet. So it may be more of a remedial style issue if it comes up for you, that is get the policies correct. And then another thing we've been asked to do and maybe worth doing is, you know, a revision of your policies with respect to workplace attendance, illness. So we're getting a lot of requests, for example, to modify travel plans, to define what will happen in the event that an employee is ill, becomes ill with COVID, what steps need to be taken, what are the employer's responses to that going to be? So we're finding that there are a lot of policy revisions to get those clear communications out to employees so that you don't have ambiguity and you don't have confusion, which of course, you know, when you do have that, leads to the possibility of a break in the employment relationship. So we've seen a lot of employers really jump on being proactive about getting those new policies in place so people have the guidelines. If we jump to the next slide, Jim. And an emerging issue that we're seeing in connection to maintaining a safe workplace is the use of different methods of screening. And I think we've all seen this in different places, anywhere from getting on an airplane if you're flying these days to, you know, I went to TELUS the other day to get an iPhone 12 and I had my temperature taken. So, you know, it's everywhere. So I think in the public's acceptance of temperature screening is you know, probably in a pretty decent place where you're not gonna get any challenges. What I have been getting calls about lately is to the extent that rapid COVID-19 nasal testing essentially becomes available, what are people's thoughts on that? And, you know, you just get into that classic counterbalance of doing what you need to do to maintain a safe workplace versus people's privacy. And Amy will talk about the privacy component in a second. I think in this context, in this climate, your duty to maintain a safe workplace is going to win out the majority of the time. A lot will, in part, I think, depend on what is your workplace, what is the physical, what are the physical characteristics of the workplace, or is it possible to have people spread out in screens and reduced workforce on a daily basis, rotating workforce, or can people work from home? Or, you know, I deal with clients in the mining industry. You know, you need your miners there. It's not possible to reduce the workforce in a meaningful way to keep operations going. So I could see in that context, to the extent that affordable rapid COVID-19 testing becomes available, I see minimal risk of privacy exposure on that front. I would say, you know, one thing worth noting is that the current Health Canada recommendations with respect to rapid testing, they've approved a couple of different U.S. Technologies in this space, but you do at this stage anyways, last I read, which wasn't that long ago, need to have trained medical personnel administering these tests. So that's not necessarily going to be practical for a lot of different workforces. It may be for certain industrial sites or mine, as I just mentioned, but not necessarily for everyone. And then, you know, the contact tracing, and Amy, I'll let you jump into this, but yeah, that's, you know, a lot's going to come down to, you know, getting buy-in from your workforce, getting consent here, because there is certainly the potential here to infringe into people's personal lives in terms of what they're up to and where they're going. And maybe this is a good point, I think, to turn it over to you, Amy, to talk a little bit about the privacy considerations.
Yeah, sounds good. And I will, if we can go to the next slide. And I'll just jump into, primarily I'm just gonna talk about here temperature screening, because that's the main one. But I just wanted to point out also with the rapid COVID testing, there was a statement released a while back from our own celebrity, Dr. Bonnie Henry, where she stated that COVID testing for asymptomatic employees at work was against public health guidance, but she didn't issue an order prohibiting it. So Max's recommendations are spot on in that you really want to ensure it's appropriate in the workplace. And for those that are higher risk, it's probably a reasonable thing to do, but in the lower risk ones, given the guidance we have from Dr. Bonnie Henry, at that point, I don't think you want to be doing that without the employee consent. Although things are changing, Max and I were talking a little bit about this. When the pandemic first broke out, it seemed that privacy was going to really take an onslaught and you know, a little bit of a backseat. We didn't really know in BC how bad it was going to get, what regions we were in, and there was a lot unknown as to what was going on. So a lot of things were being done that previously we wouldn't have viewed as okay from a privacy perspective. We sort of reached what I would call more of a normalization and a little bit back to where we were before, with the exception that obviously we're doing some temperature screening now, but we have a better idea now at this point of how far we can go. And basically, it's the same rules we've always had, which is that you really shouldn't be collecting any more information than you reasonably need. So look at your workplace. Are you low risk or high risk? You know, if you've got somebody who's in a retail setting and consistently dealing with the public, then you're probably in more of a high risk situation. And where you're in a really low risk setting, you may be able to get away with other methods aside from, you know, temperature screening, such as questions. I know probably a lot of you have gone places and they go through that whole question procedure that you're probably sick of answering. So that's one way to get around it. And the other thing is there's other alternatives that you can look into, such as enhanced PPE and things like that. So you really need to consider the whole picture. Employers generally do not require employee consent to collect personal information if it's necessary for the purposes of establishing, managing, or terminating the relationship. But there's always a notification requirement. But whether or not collecting the temperature screening is required for your workplace is going to involve an assessment of that particular workplace. But at minimum, if you're not going to obtain consent, you definitely need to notify, and that's going to involve putting up signs. You may just notify employees verbally. And we definitely also recommend updating your privacy policies. It's a great time to take a look at that right now. And then there's also the data you're recording that you're getting from that. We don't recommend obtaining and recording the data that you don't need. So for example, if you have a bunch of negative tests or employees who do not have high temperatures, there's probably not a reason to record all that, nor is that practical. But if you're going to be relying on it to, for example, deny an employee access to the workplace because they've had a high temperature or some other negative impact on the employee, you probably want to record that, or we would recommend to record that and keep it for a reasonable period of time so the employee has access to it. We can just flip to the next slide. And Max had already talked about this. I've also received a lot of questions on the COVID-19 contact tracing apps. One thing I would note is when they were first coming out, we were seeing the problem with these contact tracing apps originally was that they were collecting a lot of data and they were using third-party users to collect that data. So the data wasn't just going to your employer or whatever, it was going to a third party that may be collecting more information than would reasonably require for the employment purposes. And since then, we've seen improvements in technology and they're collecting less data than they were before, and there's more limitations on it, which is quite handy. However, at this point, we're still saying the best practice, as Max had pointed out, is get it voluntarily and with employee consent. And I think the reasons are obvious. You're tracking, potentially those apps have the ability to track the employee all over outside of their workplace, and it could be pretty invasive. And one of the other problems with them is it's premised on the fact that you have your cell phone on you. So you really, an employee could simply just leave their phone at home, and their score, some of them are based on scores, but wouldn't actually properly trace them if they did come into contact with anyone. So there's a lot of considerations to put into play before you're getting an employee to voluntarily consent to that. And one of them being, you know, how much are you going to rely on this in terms of your ability to bring them back to work and things like that. So just in terms of, if we can go to the next slide, and actually to slide 33, I'll just pass this to Max Brunette, but I will just say, like, as we've went through this, probably some of you are thinking there's some things that you need to do. We've mentioned updating privacy policies and one of the things, and Max already talked about it, is potentially looking at your employment agreements. And Max, I'll just pass it over to you.
Sure, thanks, Amy. Yeah, and so these are probably, you know, the issue when you're looking at amending employment contracts, particularly with an existing workforce, is how critically do you need that amendment? You know, what is it that you're seeking to put in? Because you have to provide consideration to your existing employees to support a material change to their terms and conditions of employment. So, you know, for example, where it always comes up is if you want to input a severance clause, or if people want to input restrictive covenants or something like that, non-comps, non-solicits. And then we get into a debate of, well, what amount of consideration do you have to provide, and will that bind, and will the clause be found enforceable? So in the context of the pandemic and some of the things we've seen that would be certainly nice to have in employment contracts, would be, you know, your contractual right to lay off employees so you avoid any potential argument of dismissal in the event you have to go into a temp layoff scenario. Certainly, and I think this is just good practice anyways, bullet two would be, you know, allowing yourself or giving yourself a discretion as an employer to make some reasonable levels of unilateral modifications to employment terms and conditions, whether that's, you know, and that's a tricky, it's a tricky clause to put in there. Because certainly if you don't front, you give yourself the right to amend compensation, I think that's going to raise a lot of eyebrows. But what you may be able to do is get some upfront agreement that, you know, roles and responsibilities may change, and you can try and bake in a little bit of added discretion to your contract. And then, of course, you know, if you don't have a severance clause in place, you know, you certainly, there's a huge amount of value in doing that to avoid back-end negotiations in the event you have to terminate. What I described, you know, what I've put on that list there, the three, you know, would I suggest that you need to run to your current workforce right now to get these in there? No. You know, these are more lessons learned from the pandemic and just a refresher on nice items to have in employment contracts. And so things to think about going forward if you utilize them that, you know, certainly have come to the forefront over the past year. And I think that is it for our slides. Shannon, could you jump over? Okay, yeah, we've got a little bit more there. So and again, all these items I've just discussed, if you do find yourself having to make material changes to your contract, you know, best position is get that employee's agreement up front. You can always do amendments by mutual agreement. And you know, hopefully you've got, you certainly want to be in a position where you can point to some level of consideration being provided if you're taking something away from that employee. Even if they agree, you may find yourself in a fight down the road that they didn't fully appreciate what the change was about and no additional compensation was provided, but some rights were taken away. You still find yourself in a fight about whether or not the consideration was valid. So you know, you do want to try and package this with some sort of change. What I often find that seems to work as a reasonably successful strategy where you do need to make changes to the existing workforce's contracts is to tie it to salary increases the next year, bonus payments. Maybe there's some aspect of the payment that's discretionary where you could point to it and say, well, you know, this particular aspect of it was specifically to support this proposed change to a contract. Where you can find yourself in a fight, and I've seen these fights, is if you tie contract changes to just the normal pay increases that an employee expects year over year, maybe it's 2.5% as an example, and then you seek to tie material contract changes to that, you could be in a fight to say, well, look, no, this is a, you know, regular expected performance or pay increase that the employee gets every year, and you're trying to tack on this change to it. But that's a pretty nuanced fight. So I wouldn't suggest that you shy away from that strategy, but just something to be aware of. And I think next slide. Yeah, that is it for us. So we've got a few questions in the chat room that we'll try to address. I think some of them we've covered. One is, does an employer have to keep paying benefits if they've temporarily laid off employees? And in BC, the answer is yes. The employment standards has a publication that says if an employee is laid off, they're still considered to be employed. Any benefits and entitlements, including vacation and leaves of absence, are protected. Another question about the leave under 5212 of the Act. And so that falls into you know, the category of if people are seeking leave based on family care situation, you know, the guiding principle is there. You're probably going to want to give them that time, and you know, you do it on an unpaid basis. But I think be flexible there, because it's ripe or fertile ground for either an employment standards complaint or human rights complaints. Okay, Amy, here's one for you on the privacy front. In regards to privacy, what are some considerations around notifying employees that someone at the workplace has tested positive? Employees are demanding to know.
Well, I think you just fall back to the original, you know, basic privacy principles, which is that you don't want to disclose more than is reasonably necessary. If you have someone who's attended, I mean, and this is really a privacy and a sort of WorkSafe BC problem. If you have somebody who's tested positive for COVID-19 and they haven't attended the workplace, there's not really a need to notify anybody in your workplace. But if there's been an exposure in your workplace, there's an obligation to notify the employees. We don't recommend, and it would be problematic from a privacy perspective to name the specific employee who's been exposed. But there would be an obligation to notify people that they have been exposed. And then in terms of notifying WorkSafe BC, just to further expand on that, we've sometimes had questions about whether you have to notify WorkSafe BC. Well, only if you end up having a positive test result as a or positive COVID case as a result of COVID-19 exposure in the workplace. So if you have an employee returning back from travel and they've not, you know, their exposure wasn't related to the workplace, and that's not something that would require WorkSafe BC. And I also just wanted to touch on the leave question a little bit further, because I think that's the 52.12 is the COVID leave, and it does expand beyond the childcare portion. I see the question is kind of goes a bit further, and one of them is about reconciling it with the public health orders. And I just wanted to say, so those apply for basically this COVID leave is broad, and it applies whenever somebody has to self-isolate or quarantine, as well as care for a child due to COVID-19 reasons, and or their employers otherwise directed them not to work. So there's quite a few circumstances where you're going to see that leave come into play. In terms of the directives from public health officers in BCDC, we do recommend that you check those guidelines on a regular basis to see if that leave applies. We have noticed that the guidelines have changed, or at least they were, particularly in the beginning of the pandemic. But, you know, currently they're basically all sort of along a similar vein, which is if you've traveled outside of Canada, you're required to self-isolate when you return. If you've had an exposure or if you have a positive test for COVID, they're all sort of along the same lines of that. And if you have an employee who's mandated to self-isolate in accordance with public health guidelines, then they are entitled to an unpaid leave. So I hope that answers that question.
Very interesting question. Just came in, and this was one that came up with one of Amy and I's clients not that long ago. And the question is, in the labor context, and I think this applies in, I assume you don't mean unionized, but I think it applies to union or non-union, in what circumstances, if any, may the employer discipline employees who violate PHO COVID orders while off duty, the example given participating in a crowded house party, particularly where the employer's operation is safety sensitive, such as a healthcare provider? That is a very interesting thing, and one that, as I said, just came up recently for us. Very interesting. What we opted to do in that scenario, because we had a violation very much like this, was to, the form of discipline we enacted was to put the employee on an unpaid leave for the isolation period until they could provide a fitness to return note. And this was in circumstances where the employee would otherwise have been entitled to paid leave, could have availed themselves of sick days or vacation days. We went with what we considered to be a disciplinary unpaid leave. It was, you know, I'm not saying that's a perfect solution, but it was some level of discipline we felt was warranted in the circumstances. But what it led us to, and I think it ties back to some of our other slides, is you may consider, you know, some amendments to your leave policies or to your sick policies to say that, you know, it's very tricky. You get into an issue of culpability, but you know, if you look at culpable absences, if you think about it in that sort of context versus non-culpable absence, you see that a lot in collective agreements, to start to push these sort of deliberate violations, assuming you can prove it into the culpable absence category, which may attract some level of discipline. Now, do you have to have that policy in place to do that? Not necessarily. You know, there are, you know, culpable absence is a disciplinable employee transgression. So you can still do it. I think you've just got to be, you know, careful about how draconian is your discipline, right? So jumping right to termination for cause, I haven't seen a case like that, but I'd say that might be considered a bit heavy-handed. But, you know, something in between, treating it as a culpable absence, not a bad strategy. We didn't get any pushback on that strategy we implemented in that scenario, so it seemed to work well, but also something to consider for your policy revisions.
Yeah, and I'd also say I've ran into this in the labor context, and one of the things that we recommended is, you know, to definitely dialogue with your union and seeing where they are on board with this, because what we found is that they're not wanting to deal with this either or to accept this, and they've been welcoming to basically communication to the effect that employees are expected to abide by these in their off-duty conduct. And it does get into a little bit of a gray area, but you know, we've addressed it in other circumstances where it had become plain and obvious that employees were gathering when they were leaving work on lunch hours and things like that. And we just had frank discussions with the union reps and things like that about how it was going to go moving forward, and that employees were expected to abide by this, and took a pretty hard stance on it. And we actually didn't get any pushback, and it did solve the issue. So sometimes there's a bit of a practical solution there as well.
Anyways, listen, we've hit 1 o'clock, and we obviously want to be sensitive to people's time. So again, thank you. I hope that you found some useful tidbits throughout the course of this seminar. If you would like a copy of our slides, please don't hesitate to email. Either of us would be happy to provide that to you. And certainly if you've got follow-up questions, happy to chat as well. So thank you very much for joining us, and hope you all have a good day.